Now we'll talk about limits to arbitrage theory. In standard finance, we talk about arbitrage theory, but in behavioral finance, we say that limits to arbitrage is applicable. So limits to arbitrage is a theory which is used to arbitrage away price inefficiencies. This theory is used by rational traders due to restrictions on funds. So when we talk about finance, we understand there's the arbitrage theory where people try to earn riskless profit by, you know, looking at the price inefficiencies which exist in two markets. So behavioral finance building blocks includes two concepts, limits to arbitrage and psychology. Limits to arbitrage basically refers to a scenario where market prices do not match fundamental value. And it has continued because individuals have refrained from arbitrage process due to cost and risk factors. And psychology concepts, as we all know, that these relates with economic agents who are not rational, that people do not always behave rationally. Now, what are the limitations to arbitrage? If you remember, when we talk about in standard finance or the investment analysis, we talk about the arbitrage theory. And as per the arbitrage principle, as a rational human being, how people behave or investors behave, if there is mispricing in two markets, or if there is mispricing of one asset with respect to its fundamental value. So how do investors behave? They will start buying from the market where the prices are cheaper and start selling the same asset or same share in the market where it is priced costlier. And people will keep on doing this buying. Investors will keep on buying and selling from the cheaper market and sell it to the costlier market till the time the prices of both the markets do not match. So then, once the equilibrium level of prices or the prices match in both the markets, then investors will stop investing or stop this arbitrage process, right? This is what arbitrage theory says. And so this can happen in two different markets, for example, with National Stock Exchange and Bombay Stock Exchange. Whenever there will be mispricing, whenever the same share of a company is less priced, it will be purchased more. And it will be sold to the market where it is priced higher. So what will happen? Wherever the price is less, people will start buying more. So suddenly price will start increasing. And it will come to an equilibrium level when both the markets will have same share price. So arbitrage process will stop. This is what arbitrage is. So to earn riskless profits because of mispricing in two different markets, we do the arbitrage thing. But behavioral finance experts says that there is limits to arbitrage. People do not unnecessary arbitrage, even if there is opportunity to earn riskless profit just because of mispricing in two markets, but still people do not arbitrage, or they will arbitrage with certain limitations, or there are certain limits to this arbitrage process that they will continue. So how do they explain it? So arbitrage is considered riskless without the need of capital. In practice, however, it does require capital and associated with several forms of risk. So we till now has been considering arbitrage theory as, you know, that the rational investor, what he's going to do, he'll look at the mispricing and he'll start buying at a cheaper rate and selling at a costly rate till the time both the prices match. But people do not do this because there is risk involved. What is the risk involved? And there is cost involved. So arbitrage needs to be performed by specialized traders who are not well diversified. It may be possible that individuals are not well diversified in terms of their debt, in terms of the capital which they use for arbitrage process. That doesn't has any leverage. That means there is not enough owned and borrowed capital involved. Assets can further decline in price in the short run, even if it is a good bet. Long term, especially in the good bet in the long term, especially in value situations, it can happen that not necessary that both the prices will equate, even if people do arbitrage. Another reason why people do not indulge into arbitrage or there is limitations to arbitrage is that clients do not have perfect knowledge about arbitrage's competence. It can thus be a rational choice to withdraw capital from an underperforming manager. This forces the manager to sell off assets, even though the expected return actually increases after the price drop. And there can be agency problem. So you cannot ask your broker to become an arbitrager on your behalf and do the trading with your money. Because the agency problem breaks down the link between greater mispricing and higher expected utility from client's perspective. This can result in irrational prices while the arbitragers and their client themselves act rationally. So there can be, because of other agency factors which are playing a role in the market, it can happen that the prices still behave irrational as compared to even if you and your broker is behaving rationally. So the conditions to arbitrage are that there should not be law of one price. That means the same asset do not trade in all the markets at the same price. No two assets with same cash flows should trade at the same price. So this is basic logic. An asset should not be traded at its present value discounted at risk-free return if it is future price is known or the asset has significant cost of storage. So whenever valuation of assets is done, if you are studying derivatives, then you will understand this concept better. So whenever we are talking about future value of any asset, so we adopt the discounting or compounding principles as you have studied in time value of money. So any asset, when their value is calculated, for example, to decide that whether an asset is underpriced or overpriced, so we look at the time of investments, we look at the rate of return it can give you, and then we calculate its discounted value. So either we calculate its present value or we calculate its future value. And if there is a mispricing, the actual price of the asset and the future value or the compounded value shows difference, then only people indulge in trading. And from that perspective, it is being said that, you know, cost of storage also matters. So if there is any cost of storage that will be involved in that particular asset, that needs to be added back. So arbitrageurs are those players in the market who try to make the profit from mispricing in the market by making simultaneously trades and make riskless profit. Now, there can be three types of arbitrageurs: uninformed arbitrageurs, passive arbitrageurs, and active arbitrageurs. So uninformed arbitrageurs can get abnormal returns because of market inefficiencies. Passive arbitrageurs can get abnormal returns because of private information about some particular outcome which is going to happen. But active arbitrageurs, they get abnormal return from the market when they have knowledge about their own presence, which can influence the bid outcome or the deal which they are entering into. There can be three types of arbitrage: riskless or true arbitrage, and risky arbitrage. Riskless arbitrage is an arbitrage which attempts to profit by exploiting price differences of identical financial instruments on different markets or in different forms. So if there is, you know, there's no risk involved, then that is known as riskless arbitrage. But there can be risk arbitrage also, which is related with speculation. And some of the risk arbitrage, although these are not a part of your syllabus, but just to know the names if you want to understand, there can be statistical arbitrage, pair trading, takeover arbitrage, liquidation arbitrage, covered interest arbitrage, uncovered interest arbitrage. Now, what are the costs involved in arbitrage? There are three types of costs. One is fundamental risk. Second is noise trader risk, and third can be transaction cost. Because of these three costs, we say that irrational investor or investors in general do not indulge into arbitrage process, or they limit themselves from whatever arbitrage they are going to do. So these three points are important while when we talk about the concept called limits to arbitrage. So fundamental risk, as you all understand, refers to the risk of new bad information which arrives to the market after the security has been purchased. This risk could be perfectly hedged by buying a closely related product, but unfortunately, substitute securities are rarely perfect to make it impossible to remove all fundamental risk. Now, fundamental risk can come from that, you know, if you are, because many times it is not possible when you're going for an arbitrage process that you have the same asset being traded in two different markets at two different prices. But if you want to indulge into such kind of an activity where there are two different assets which you want to trade, and you choose the another asset which is the best, which is perfectly hedged, right? So which is most perfect hedge by buying a closely related product. So in that case, you're not able to remove the fundamental risk of the of investment. Second risk is noise trader risk. It is the risk that the mispricing deteriorates in the short run because there's a possibility that pessimistic traders become more pessimistic about the future. Noise trading risk is very important because of the link to other agency problem. It can force people such as hedge fund managers to liquidate their positions early, bringing them unnecessary and unwanted steep losses. Noise trader risk can have agency effects, time horizon effects, mispricing can force arbitrageurs to liquidate early. So what is this noise trader risk is? Noise trader risk is about that noise. Do you know what is noise? Noise is something which you cannot identify, that who is making this noise. You cannot make out why somebody is making this noise. So it's not that somebody is communicating. Noise is absurd. Noise is which you cannot identify. So many of the time, the information or the fluctuations in the market is about nobody knows what is happening. So when markets fall immediately, or you see that there is for unnecessary reason, market is going up. So it's all noise, something which you cannot identify and predict from the market. So noise is about that. So sometimes there is noise in the market because of which the arbitrager, the person who's actually, trying to play with the mispricing of information and trying to buy and sell by avoiding all kind of risk, it may be possible that whatever he is seeing in the market is just noise. And in the market, there is a lot of trading which happens where people are not aware of what they are actually doing, but they are just following the herd, or they are just following the some news which has come and everybody is selling, so they are also selling. So that noise can be a short-term thing. So all that trading which happens, which is unpredictable, for which there is no explanation, that trading is known as noise trading. So it may be possible that whatever mispricing you see, that is because of some noise trading, because of which it may happen that arbitrager is forced to liquidate early, or some hedge fund managers, they liquidate their positions early and they end up having huge losses. And third cost is the implementation. Yeah.
Ma'am, how is this bad information being mentioned in fundamental risk is different from noise?
See, bad information is you are at least aware that a negative news has come, which is fundamentally, which is about a company, and that's a bad information about a company, right? But noise is that you are not aware. Sometimes people say that, you know, today the market will go up, but suddenly nobody knows that why the market is crashing today. Just because everybody is selling, or just because some unknown factors because everybody is selling, so everybody starts selling. So that is noise trading, where noise is which is unpredictable. You can't say that it is because of this reason or that reason. But fundamental risk can obviously arise from a company factor. It can arise from a macroeconomic factor also. It can be good or bad information which is coming.
Okay.
So transaction costs are there whenever you are trading. For example, bid-ask spread, brokerage fees, expense ratio, short sale constraints. All of these factors make arbitrage process costly, and mispricing may exist, known as limited arbitrage. So because of these reasons also, many times you find that there is differences in the prices of the same asset in two different markets, but still people are not buying and selling, because they may assume that it is this mispricing is because of noise, this mispricing is because of some fundamental risk which can be there, and this mispricing may stay because of transaction costs that are involved if people will indulge into arbitrage. So that's why many times people do not end up playing in the arbitrage. There can be other costs. For example, there can be agency costs. So arbitrage process includes costs that relates to time, relates to limits imposed by variations in the performance. So fund managers, they themselves are not the owners of the capital. There can be principal agent problem. So they sometimes take decisions that are necessary to maintain their job rather than giving optimum returns to the investors. So that can be another reason why not all advantageous opportunities are, you know, taken care of. There can be horizon risk. Horizon risk arises when price reach to their fair level with so much delay that it is beyond the expected horizon and it is not worth it. So the risk reduces the actual returns generated when compared with the estimated returns. So things happen in such a delayed manner that now everybody knows that this is the fair price, it has, the level has reached, but there is no fun, or there is, you see that waiting for so long will create its own kind of risk. So that is why people may not indulge in arbitrage. So when we talk about the concept called limits to arbitrage in behavioral finance theory, so we are talking about that arbitrage is a good thing. Arbitrage process, everybody understands that people, a rational investor will end up doing arbitrage wherever he will see mispricing. But many times practically, markets have shown that arbitrage process is not happening. Why it is not happening? So behavioral finance tries to explain the reason that because of the limits to arbitrage, because there are certain costs involved, there are certain risks involved, because of which investors tend to resist themselves for entering into arbitrage, or even if they enter into arbitrage, they will do it with certain limitations or with certain limits assigned to themselves. That's all about these three important concepts related to the basics of behavioral finance.